Everybody have one of these? Please get it out. Everybody. There's going to be times in our life that last Monday I was at our state penitentiary and I had mass at the for our brothers there incarcerated. And holding, he was holding God's word. A man who had been convicted of killing six people. He had just been in solitary confinement for 7.5 years. And he told me, God has forgiven me. God has restored me. He had read this book, half of this book, he had read the whole thing, God's word, for the last 7.5 years. Gentlemen, there's some seats up here. There's the other side. There's some seats here. So come sit in the front. We'll be bad Catholics here, but come on. Go to John 10:10. John 10:10. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. There's right here, over here. There's like 4 seats, 5 seats. No, we don't say page numbers. Find it. Very good. 113. Will help because we're Catholic. It'll take us 20 minutes to find it. John 10:10. I asked Mike Schulte when he asked me a year ago to come up over here. It's not always easy to leave the parish during Lent. My godparents live here, and who are my aunt and uncle, and my cousin who is out in Des Moines with Xavier High School. But I said I'd come over, but I said I would not come unless everyone had a Bible in their hand when I came. And so thank you, gentlemen, for doing that for us. John 10:10. The thief, now it's going to be a little different in this translation. I memorize it in NAB. A thief comes only. The only reason for the thief, according to Jesus, the thief comes only to steal, slaughter, and destroy. But I came, I'm going to say it in a little different translation, but I came that they may have life. Now he doesn't stop there. Jesus never stops at a point. He always goes over and beyond. A thief comes only to steal, slaughter, and destroy. But I came that what? They may have life and what? Have it more abundantly. Ask yourself the question. Do we have this abundant life? This is my favorite image of Jesus. The divine mercy. The best image is this one. A thief, say a thief.
Amen.
Comes.
Only.
To steal.
To steal.
What has he stolen in your life and in my life in the last 2 days? What has he stolen from us? A thief comes to steal. Only. There's only one point to the thief. According to the truth, according to the love incarnate, a thief comes only to steal, slaughter, and destroy. And the man who had murdered six people, that was part of his life for 50-some years. The last 7.5 years, he has accepted Jesus. He has accepted Jesus. Not here. Here. A thief comes only. Say, a thief comes only.
To steal.
Because he's speaks with passion and love. Amen? Amen. And his name is Jesus. A thief comes only to steal, slaughter, and can you imagine him saying this to his followers? A thief comes only to steal, slaughter, but I came that they may have life. It's the Greek word zoe. That they may have life and have it more abundantly. John uses the word life more than any of the other evangelists. I am the way, truth, and life, John 14:6. Start memorizing what he says. John 10:10. Say John 10:10. Say John 10:10. Say John 10:10. So we need to have this vision according to the documents of Vatican II. Back in the 60s. For me, the greatest document of Vatican II is Dei Verbum on the Word of God. In paragraph 7. Paragraph 7 says that the essential way to know Jesus Christ is the Gospels. And no one knows them. You ever notice at Mass? Right now we say, praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Then we come up to the ambo. What are people doing during the Gospel? There was a guy 800 years ago that didn't have a printed Word of God. Didn't have it because there was no printing press at the time. He grew up in Portugal. Then he became an Augustinian. Then he became a Franciscan. His name is St. Anthony of Padua. He fell in love with the Word, but he didn't have it printed. He would go to Mass and listen. And they said that St. Anthony of Padua, if the Gospels would have been lost, he would have been able to tell everything that's in the Gospels. Because he came to realize, oh my gosh, this is the life of Jesus. So say John 10:10. Okay, so Jesus, there's a lot of stuff that you have to memorize and that I have to memorize. I'm going to challenge you today on the things that I do. And one thing I do is memorize the Gospels. A couple years ago, I started memorizing John. And then when people ask me questions about the Gospels, bam, he's the love of my life. Is he the love of your life? Say yes.
Yes.
But I need him more. Say, I need him more.
I need him more.
Each of us do. That's why we have this right here today. That's why you're going to take this home. And in a year, it's going to be so ripped up, you're going to have to get another one. Because you're going to read it and read it and read it and read it. You're going to go out in public and read it. You're going to go to the coffee shop and read it. You're going to get some guys to go and you're going to read them together in public. Start doing that. It'll shock people a little bit. They'll be like,
what are they doing? They're reading the Gospel. So say John 10:10. So that's a great verse. That's a great verse. Don't forget the verse. I came that they may have life and have it more abundantly. I do a lot of work with high school kids. I do a lot of work with young people, with boys most especially, with young men. I work once a month with a bunch of young guys and they read the Gospels every day because we have a group text and they text each other to make sure that they're reading the Gospels. And they challenge each other and they've read the New Testament now 3 times, backwards and forwards. And we have these Bible studies together, and they come in, and they have to know Gospel, they have to know them from memory. They have to, John 10:10, what's it say? A thief comes, all these guys. They do plays, football plays, they do basketball plays, amen? Go to Luke 9:23. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, find Luke 9:23. Say Luke 6. Go to Luke 6, sorry, I messed up. 6:23. Hold on just a second. Luke 6:27. I'm going to let you live Luke 6:27 right now. You're going to literally live this verse right now. Okay? Someone read it who's got a loud voice. Okay, stop right there. 3 words. Say, love your enemies.
Love your enemies.
Say it again.
Love your enemies.
Okay, you're gonna live that verse literally right now. Because that's your enemy here, right? Love your enemies. I'm a big Husker fan. So I thought, okay, what verse would I introduce them with me? I thought, how about Luke 6:27, love your enemies, okay? So, love your enemies. This is probably the hardest thing to read in the life of Jesus. What's he say? Love your enemies. Do good to those who hate you. Pray for those who persecute you. It's a Friday evening, bad week. There's someone at work that's literally an enemy to us. They're persecuting us. They're rude to us. They're impatient with us. We got coworkers, people in our neighborhood, people who persecute us, people who don't like us. Last week in Yemen, in the Middle East, they went into a missionary of charity place and they executed four nuns. Shot them in the head, tied them up, and executed them. Love your enemies, do good to those who hate you. Pray for those, read this. This is something, if you have a highlighter, you want to highlight this. Love your enemies. We do not go to heaven if we don't love our enemies. If we hate anyone, we don't go to heaven. Love your enemies, do good to those who hate you. And you have to forget what people do. We have to forget when people wrong us, according to Jesus. Love your enemies, do good to those who hate you. Pray for those who persecute you. Listen to what it says. This is not Father Courtney, this is not Archbishop Jacobs, this is not a priest or a deacon, this is not a nun, this is Jesus. Love your, this is not the church. Love your enemies, pray for those who persecute you. See what he says there? Bless those who curse you, pray for those who abuse you. To him who strikes you on the cheek, offer the other one as well. There was a little girl that believed that. She lived in Albania. Her name was Agnes. She became a nun. She went to India. And one day she was trying to get into a communist country. And she asked, she said, may we have some money for the poor? And the communist dictator spit at her face. And she said, thank you, that was for me. Now may I have something for the poor? She lived that verse right there. You want to live the Word of God?
Yes.
Say yes.
Yes.
Some of us come here today broken. That's why we're going to have confession today. Are you broken?
Yes.
Yes, so am I. But we have someone that fixes us. And he go to John 14:6. Okay, this is at the Last Supper. This is right before he dies. So it's a Thursday night. You've got this issue, this issue, this issue. You've been married 15 years, 20 years. Your wife wants more compassion. She wants more love. She wants more affection. And you're not giving her affection like she wants. So you've got to go to the man who is compassionate, who is love. John 14. He says it. He's quite clear here. Jesus is clear. And that's why people follow him. Because he's clear and intense. It's John 14. This is up in the Last Supper. This is in the upper room. I'll be there in 3 weeks. I'll pray for you in the upper room. Only the Pope can have Mass there in the upper room. I hope someday the Israel government will give it to the Catholic Church. But right now, only the Pope. It's pretty sweet, right? Only the Pope can go there and offer Mass. Because he's the Pope. Okay? So John 14, 6. Upper room. Wait till you go to the upper room. You got to go to Israel. You want to go to somewhere, go to Israel. Don't go to stinking Disneyland. Go to the Holy Land. Drives me nuts. The other Holy Land is Wrigley Field, too. Okay? I'm a big Cub fan. Someone says, why are you a Cub fan? I go, because of the word hope. 1 Corinthians 13:13. Okay? So John, yeah, lots of hope. It's going to happen this year. If it happens, you better go to confession because the world might end. Okay? So John 14, 6, you're frustrated. You get frustrated. You take it out on people. We take it out on people, right? When we get frustrated and angry, right? If we have anger in our heart, I guarantee you there's one guy in here, and it's maybe me, that's got anger in their heart. They've got bitterness in their heart. They've got something in your heart. You're going to get rid of it today because you're going to go to confession. We're going to hear confessions today. John 14, 6. Look at what he says here. Look what he says. John 14, 6. First he says, look at 1, John 14, 1. Let your hearts be troubled. Let your hearts not be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I will go to prepare a place for you? We don't earn our salvation. He goes and prepares it for us. He did it on the cross. He did it at the resurrection. Wait till you go to the Holy Land. I'll have Mass in the tomb of the resurrection. It'll be my fourth time there in 7 years. It's the greatest place ever to go. And it is safe. It is safe. Don't listen to what the media says. Look at what he says there. Believe in me. Look at what he says it here. This is Jesus. You got to read this by yourself alone. Look what he says. He says, and when I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back again. Here's the second coming. Have you been to a cemetery lately? That's why they're all buried. Their heads are buried east. So when he comes from the east, their heads, they're going to come up. In our cemetery, everyone's buried, their heads looking east. I just did a burial, and I think of that every time I go to the cemetery and think, oh my gosh, when Jesus comes from the east, all those people are going to come out of the ground. He's coming back. He's coming back. Look what he says here. And you know the way where I am going. You know the way. Say, you know the way. Say that. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way? You know what happened to Thomas? He always gets the bad rap, right? Doubting Thomas. You know where he went? He went to India, and he was martyred in India. And you can go to the burial place of St. Thomas. You meet anyone from India, they love St. Thomas. Because Thomas brought the gospel there. Thomas said this. Then Jesus says to him, say, I am the way. You're going to need that, brothers. We're going to need that. We might need that today or tomorrow when we get frustrated or we have a son or a daughter who aren't going to Mass and their salvation is dependent upon some of this and we get worried and we get frustrated or we have some addiction to alcohol or the internet or we have some addiction to anger or we have some problem in our life. He says, I am the way. Isn't that great? Yes?
Yes?
It's so awesome. I am the way. So you stop for a moment and you're like, you're the way. You're the way. That way isn't always easy though. Go to John 16:33. Guys, you got to read the book if you haven't read it yet. It'll take you 3 months. I wish I could have brought some of my brothers. They're called the Brothers of the Beatitudes, my Bible study of guys. I asked a few of them to come, but they're cattle farmers. They're calving, and they had chores this morning. I wish I could have brought Paul and Isaac, their two brothers. They're 19 and 20 years old. And their Bible, I gave them one of these, their Bible smells like cows. Because they read it. I said, read it where you work. And theirs does. So let me smell it. Ah, oh, price of money. Right? John 16:33. Look what he says here. This is a great, an amazing verse. John 16:33. When you get your highlighter, I want you to highlight this verse. John 16:33. A friend of mine has this as his personalized license plate. Is JN 1633. Look what it says there. Right? He says, I have told you this, that in me you have peace. In me, not in a building, not in a priest, not in a bishop. We do not put our faith in the priest. I don't go to Mass anymore because this priest said this. It's not about the priest. I've told you this so that in me you will have peace. In the world you will have, what does he say? You will have tribulation. You will have suffering. Who do you think had the most suffering in the last 100 years in the world? I think his name is Carol Wotia. Carol Wotia. When he was 9 years old, mother dies. 3 years later, his brother died, Edmund. At the age of 20, his father, Carol, died. Then he gets shot. He gets stabbed. Correct? We don't know about the stabbing. You want to read a great book. I saw a picture of Jason Everett out there. The Five Loves of John Paul II. You will have trouble. You will have tribulation in this world. But look what it says there. But be of what?
Cheer.
Think of the last week. Were we of good cheer? Were we uppers? Were we of good cheer? He says, be of good cheer. Or we're a big fat grouch. Anyone a big fat grouch in the last week? Yeah. Yeah, so yeah, we were, right? Be of good cheer.
Be of good cheer.
Say John 16:33. I hope you highlight that, write it in your own handwriting, and put it up on your fridge. put it out in your man cave, put it out in your, in my town, in my parish. I live in a small little town of 75 people. Okay, we have a beautiful, huge, gothic, gorgeous church with 40 feet ceilings. It's gorgeous. But guys like to go out to their shed in my church. Okay? And one of the farmers I went to visit, he had this verse written in his own handwriting. Because he's going to have trouble with his combine, maybe. Or the corn's not going to work, or they're going to have a calf that dies. You will have tribulation, but be of good cheer. Why? What does he say? I've overcome the world. I've conquered the world. It's the word Nike in Greek. Nike. Nike, victory. That's where that word comes from. They didn't want to name their shoe company Loser. So they used the Greek word. But the Nike word is all over the Bible. Nike. The host that I get, I have the word N-I-K-A on my host. So when I look at it every day, I remind myself, I got to get victory today. Do I earn their victory? Say no. Who earns the victory? Jesus. Who?
Jesus.
Now, who believed that the greatest? Who believed that the greatest? I think the person who wrote it the best was St. Paul. How many letters did he write? 13 or 13?
13.
Say 13 letters of St. Paul.
13.
Most people don't even know this book. They don't even know the New Testament. They don't know how many books are in the Bible. They don't know how many letters St. Paul wrote. There's 8 universal letters. We call them Catholic. It starts with Hebrews, right? James, 1 Peter, 2 Peter, 1 John, 2 John, 3 John, Jude. Those are the 8 books. This book is unbelievable. I hope you start reading it. I hope you start reading it. I will conquer the world. Say, I've conquered the world. Say that. What thing do you need conquering in your life? What is it? What is it do I need conquering in my life? Think about those things. If we let Jesus in, say John
16:33.
Say John 10:10. Say, a thief
comes only
to steal, slaughter, and destroy. But I came that they may have life and have it more abundantly. See, when you have it on your head, you're going to have difficulties and struggles. All of us will. But we can overcome them by ourselves. And go to John 15:5. John 15:5, it's page 120. This is probably 1 o'clock in the morning on Good Friday when he says this. There's how many gospels? 4. How many gospels?
4.
St. Jerome, Pope Paul VI said there's 5. And the fifth one is the Holy Land. Who's been to the Holy Land? Nice. Who's been to Disneyland? Isn't that interesting? Now, I know the Holy Land's more expensive. Except if you go to a buddy of mine went to the Disneyland. He came back, he had to go to confession. Because, like, water was $4. He's like, Father, I'm sinning right now of anger. He texts me a picture. So this cost me $4. And I have 3 kids. And they wanted water. Okay, I said, you should have went to the Holy Land. Okay. So John 15:5, this is one of my favorite verses. Look at what he says here. I am the vine. You are the branches. We want to be the vine. We want to be the vine. A guy told me yesterday, he's hurting. He's got his son who just, he's, you know, he's 40s. He's frustrated with his son. He came to Mass. He's frustrated. After Mass, he's like, Father, I have to talk to you. He goes, I'm trying to be the vine, because he's memorized this verse. He's memorized this verse. I am trying to be the vine, not the branch. I am the vine, you are the branches. Whoever remains in me and I in him will bear much fruit, for without me you can do nothing. That's not what he says there, right there in this book. Not Father Courtney, not Father Johnson. This book, this is the truth. Unbelievable. Say, I am the vine. You might need that this week. Well, that's right. You're in control of my life. You're in control of my life. I am the vine, you are the branches. Whoever remains in me and I in him. Do you see what he does in this verse? Whoever remains in me, because we have to choose him every day. He says in Revelation 3:20, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone opens the door, I'm coming in. It's Revelation 3:20. We can't go to all the verses. Revelation 3:21, he says, Victor, I am the vine. You are the branches. Whoever remains in me. You got to remain in him. And he loves that word because if you read John 15, he uses it all the time. Whoever remains in me and I in him will bear much fruit, for without me you can do nothing. For without me you can do nothing. I teach little kindergartners these verses because they can memorize like nobody's business. They're like, without me you can do nothing. Without me you can do nothing. You should see little kids memorize. Okay? That's John say, I am the vine. You are the branches. Then say, Jesus, I will not be the vine this week. I'll be the branch. And I'll remain in you, and you'll remain in me. Because without you, I can do nothing. That's what he says. It's not brain surgery, brothers. Memorize it. People die for this book. In the Middle East, if they find people have a Bible, they shoot them in the head. And people still carry a Bible around. Isn't that great? Don't you love that type of passion? Do people love Jesus? Do people use his name in vain? Yeah, I was at the Husker game against Iowa. Nice job, guys. You guys won. The guy behind me used Jesus' name 22 times in vain. He was an Iowa fan. There's a lot of other Nebraskans doing the same thing. This guy behind me, the whole game, every time he said something, I said, one Hail Mary. So after the game, I turned back to him, and I said, sir, you must believe in Jesus. It was freezing cold, so they couldn't see the collar. And he's like, yes? I said, you said my best friend's name throughout the game. He's like, I did? I go, yeah, here's a holy card, a picture of him, my best friend. Have a great day. He's like, thank you, Father. And then I went like this. Then I went, I work for him. Now, a buddy of mine said to me, why did you do that? I said, well, let me ask you this, Tony. If behind you, and now Tony would do this, but he said, why did you do it? I said, well, Tony, if you and I were standing together and the guy behind you was busting on your wife, and taking your wife's name in vain, and saying your wife Cindy's name in vain, would you turn around? The love of my life is Jesus Christ. You ever done that? You ever said to someone, hey, don't use his name. Don't use his name. Go to Mark 13:13. This is great. Guys, thanks for coming today. Mark 13:13. Mark 13:13. Say Mark, you got a lot of Bible verses in your head now. John 10:10, John 16:33. Luke 6:27, you start memorizing them. They'll change your life. Okay? Mark 13:13. Look what he says there. And you, it's page 55, and you will be hated by all for my name's sake. You will be hated by all. We stand for the traditional definition of marriage, which Jesus talks about in Matthew 18. This high school kid, you know, teaching on traditional marriage. Well, why do you believe it, Father? I don't know, because Jesus says it in Matthew 19. That's good enough for me. He says what marriage is in Matthew 19. I'm sold. Mark 13, you will be hated by all because of my name, but those who persevere to the end will be saved. Mark 13:13. Isn't that a great verse? You read Mark. It's only 16 chapters. Start with Mark. If you've never read a gospel, read Mark because it's the shortest. One of the guys in my parish, he had never read a book in his entire life. Started reading. He goes, which gospel should I? Because I preach on it all the time to read the gospels. And I said, start with Mark. He started with Mark, Luke, John. He works at a factory. He'd bring it in. His coworker said, what are you reading? He goes, I'm reading the Bible. I'm reading the New Testament. I'm reading the Gospels. Then he shared Jesus. They had worked together for 12 years. He goes, I didn't know you were a Christian. You will be, say, you will be hated by all because of my name. But those who persevere to the end, you got to go all the way to the end. You got to go. You got to be faithful to the last second, to the end. Don't you love when sports athletes go to the end? They go to the end and they go to the end and they go until they can't give anymore. You love that or what? You love to go to the most popular country singer is Garth Brooks. He sells out like this. He just sold out a bunch of concerts in Des Moines like this because he goes seven, because he goes and goes and goes and goes. Do Christians do that? Do you do that? Do I do that? I can wear this. I can say I'm a priest. Does not mean I go to the end. But who does go to the end? Jesus. Who goes to the end? Jesus. Go to John 13, 1. Can you hear Bible pages? Do we love being Catholic?
Yes.
Isn't it great? Isn't it the best thing ever? Love it. Someone said, Father, what do you love about being a priest? This high school guy goes, Father, what do you love about being a priest? I said, it's very simple. Every day, I take a piece of bread, and I say Matthew 26, 26, Mark 14, 22, Luke 22, 19, and that piece of bread becomes the God who created the moon and the sun. That's why I'm a Catholic. That's why I'm a priest. That alone right there. Matthew 26, 26, Mark 14, 22, Luke 22, 19. Right there. I say it every day. I said it today in the chapel here. This is my body. Right there. Four words. Jesus. Not when I lift him up. Four words. This is my body. Even if I don't even believe it. As long as I say the words, it's him. That powerful or what? Okay? And what are people doing at Mass? They're bored. Half of them. Amen? It drives me completely nuts. I want to scream my head off. I'm like, love! It's love! They get more excited about a stupid football game. Okay? Where are we at? Where did I say?
13-1.
Okay, 13-1. I get a little excited. Hello. One of my parishioners said, you need to be on Ritalin. I didn't know what Ritalin was. I was talking to my sister after this kind of grouchy guy said it to me. I'm like, Terry, what's Ritalin? And she goes, it's for people it's for kids that they are like ADHD. I'm like, ooh. And she goes, next time tell me you should be on Prozac. I go, what's that? He goes, that's when you're grouchy. I was like, ooh, no, I better not. Love your enemies, do good to those who hate you, pray for those who persecute you. Luke 6, 27. John 13, 1, now before the feast of Passover, when Jesus knew that his hour had come to depart out of this world to the Father, having loved his own who were in the world. What's it say?
He loved them to the end.
Don't you love that? That was our verse for one of the chaplain sports teams that I chaplained with the high schools I taught at. That was our thing. He loved them to the end. So you got to go to the end for that basketball. You got to go in for that timeout. You got to go in. You love them to the end. Now, what's that mean for a Catholic? That means to love the Mass, to go to confession. That means to pray this little thing, read the Bible, and to pray this. Right? The rosary takes 15 minutes. We have 1,440 minutes in a day, and we can't say this for 15 of it. It's like, really? He loved them to the end. Say that. He loved them to the end. So what's that mean for you as a how many of you are married? Okay? So a lot of you. What does that mean to love to the end to your wife? To love to the end. What's that? Till death. How about every day? How about every single day? When you go to confession today, bless me, Father, I don't love to the end with my wife on A, B, and C. Or maybe just say A. I don't love her this way. Because we're all imperfect. He loved them to the end. He loved them to the end. Go to Matthew. Go to Matthew chapter 14, 22. Guys, start memorizing it. Okay. I was anointed in 06. I've been a priest 6 years. I've been a priest 16 years. The rectory I moved into, the parish I moved into, we didn't have cable, and I love baseball. So at night, I would record the game during the day and then watch it at night. After I get home from my meetings and stuff, and it would be, 9:30 at night, and then I'd watch the game for 3 hours, and I'd go to bed. That's what I still do today. I don't know the score, and then that's my relaxing time. People say, baseball's so boring. I go, it's relaxing. especially if the Cubs are winning. It's like, thank you, Jesus. Okay? He loved them to the end. So here is Matthew 14. You're going to drown. You're going to be drowning this week. Look what he does. Then he made his disciples get into the boat and go before him to the other side. That would take about 2 hours. In 3 weeks, we'll stay on the Sea of Galilee. Wait till you go there. And we get in a boat, we go to the other side. It's a lake. It's not really a sea. Okay, it's not that big. And remember, they grew up on that sea, the Sea of Galilee. Peter would have grown up. He would have fished there for years and years and years and years and years. They knew that sea like the back of your hand. I went to Florida and fished over Christmas break. My friends invited me down to Florida. And I'm not a fisherman, but he goes, it's very easy. A captain will get on a boat, we'll go fishing. This guy knew a lot of the part of the Gulf. He's like, there'll be fish here. I'm like, how do you know that? The sea is like huge. He goes, Father, I've been on this sea for 45 years. I know where fish are, and that's because of this story. I love this. So they know this so well. And he's dismissed the crowds. He went up the hills by himself to pray. So he goes up the hill. They're in the boat. When evening came, he was there alone. But by that time, the boat was many furlongs distant from the land, beaten down by the waves. You ever had that? You ever been beaten down, frustrated, angry, beaten down by the waves? We get like this. This is my favorite story, probably, of the whole New Testament. For the wind was against them. You ever had the wind against you? Yep, the wind against. Look what it says. And in the fourth watch, that's about 3 a.m. So they're still, it's about 4 o'clock in the afternoon when they get on the boat, because earlier in the chapter it says green grass. It would have been about the springtime, and they would have gotten into that sea. It would have taken them 2 hours to go to the other side. They would have gotten there about 6-7 o'clock at night. It's 3 o'clock in the morning. They're still on that sea. They feel abandoned. They feel like, where is he? Where'd he go? Why isn't he here to help us? Can you imagine what they're praying? Like, where's Jesus at? He wants them to feel abandoned. He wants them to. So they know what it means to abandon themselves to him. They want him to lean on him. Someone here this morning is probably going through this right now. Maybe you've lost your job. Maybe you're having a struggle, a difficulty. You've had an addiction to pornography, or you've had an addiction to alcohol. And that's your wind. That's your sea. But when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified, saying, it's a ghost. And they cried out for fear. Can you imagine they crying out? Been on that sea for hours and hours and hours and hours, brothers. Have you had that in your life? I guarantee you, each of us at some point in our life, we feel drowning, we're angry, all this stuff. Look what it says. This is where the gospels come alive. But immediately he spoke to them. So when they cry out in fear, this story, he immediately answers. Take heart, it is I. Have no fear. Have no fear. Maybe that's your line you're going to put on a note card. Have no fear. Have no fear. Have no fear. He's given us the abundant life. John 10:10. Love your enemies. Luke 6:27. Love to the end. John 13:1. Love to the end. Mark 13:13. You got to know his life. You got to have his words in your head. That's according to Dei Verbum, paragraph 7. Don't you love the gospel? In my church, every Sunday, we have a big production when the gospel's read. I have candles, boys with candles. And they carry candles over, and we stand, and I incense the gospel, because the gospel is powerful. It's powerful. That's why we stand. You need this in your life. So do I. Do we need this in our life? Mr. Notre Dame there, do you need this in your life? What's your name? Will? Will, do you need this in your life? What grade are you in? 8th grade, right? A little drama sometimes. 8th grade girls, I teach 8th grade girls. There's a little drama sometimes. Good night, right? Okay? Love to the end, love to the end. Say, I'm going to love to the end. He loves to the end here. Look what he does. I love Jesus. Peter answers him, Lord, if it is you, bid me to come out on the water. I love about Peter. He's not shy about talking. But 90 times he talks in the New Testament. Then he falls. But he's humble because he gets out. He's like, okay, I'm going to do this. Look what he says here. He said, come. So Peter got out of the boat. He got out of the boat. I got to do this in my parish. I got to do a very tough thing here in the next couple weeks about something. And I'm avoiding it like the plague. But one parishioner came to me yesterday. He said, Father, you got to do it. I'm like, no. I got to get out of my boat. And I don't want to. Okay? Peter got out of the boat. Did you see the movie The Bible? That was the series on television. When I was watching that, I paused it and took a picture of that scene where his foot touches the sea. I love that imagery. I'm a big image guy. This is boring. I can't get into it. I'm gonna throw up. I don't have time to read the Bible. We spend more time on the throne than we do. This is what Father Larry Richards says. He goes, guys, spend more time taking a dump than reading the Bible. I went to a men's conference when he said that. I was like, you're hilarious. Is it true or what?
Yes.
It is. So look what he does. Come. So Peter got out of the boat, walked on the water, and came to Jesus. When's he sink, guys? When he took his face off him. When he took his eyes off Jesus. Jesus immediately reached out his hand and caught him, saying to him, oh, you of little faith, why did you doubt? I hope that I never, ever hear Jesus say that to me, but I know he does. He's saying it to me, the thing I'm avoiding in my parish of doing, that I've got to do with a parishioner and change something that's happening in our parish. I got to go to this guy and tell him he needs to change or he can't run this organization in our parish. That's why I love her. That's why I love Mary. Because Mary doesn't ever pause. She's always faithful. Go to Luke 22, 42. Isn't this great studying the Bible Saturday morning in a gym? Luke 22, 42. Luke 22, 42. Say Luke 22, 42. So someone says to you, this is the verse about yes, Jesus is yes. Luke 22, 42. Luke 22, 42. Luke 22, 42. When I'm teaching high school kids, I'm always like, Luke 22. They're like, stop! We get it! But then when they're taking the test, they're like, Luke 22, 42. Because they got to memorize it. Look what he says there. This is when he sweat blood. This is after he had the Last Supper. He'd been eating, drinking wine. It's about 1 o'clock in the morning. He says this verse. Father, if you are willing, remove this chalice from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. Not my will, but yours be done. That's got to be in your head, brothers. Not my will. I'll be the branch. You're the vine. Not my will, but yours be done. Not my will, but... Say Luke 22, 42. Not my will, but yours be done. Say it. So I got a guy in my peer, or a friend of mine, they're totally into buying the church's teaching of no birth control and so on. He's a hero. They got 6 kids. His wife wants another baby. And he thought, oh, I think we're done. He goes, Father, why should I say yes? I said, Luke 22, 42, read it. Luke 22, 42, not my will but yours be done. But not my will but yours be done. The guy that I'm trying to help discern if he's going to go to the seminary. He said, Father, what verse should I memorize? I said, Luke 22, 42, not my wills but yours be done. He goes, I don't know if I want to do this. I go, it's not up to you, big H. It's what Jesus wants. Not my will but yours be done. Not my will but yours be done. Say, not my will, but yours be done. Young guys, 8th graders over there, okay? Maybe you'll go to the seminary, okay? It's the greatest life ever, okay? Unbelievable. I met these 3 8th grade boys. Okay, not my will, but yours be done. Say that. There's the verse you put up. And you take this little thing and you highlight it. Not my will, but yours be done. Say Luke 22, 42. Now go to Mark 15. You got so many verses in your head. Your wife's, you're going to go home, you're going to be like, Luke 22, 42, not my will, but yours be done. John 10, 10. John 10, John 10, John 10, 10, 10. Okay.
Studying the Bible is boring. Being a Catholic is boring.
It's like, seriously? Okay? What did we say? Oh, yeah, Mark 15:15. Mark 15:15. We're going to celebrate this. We're going to celebrate Mark 15:15 in a couple weeks. Read Mark 15:15. So Pilate, wishing to satisfy the crowd, released for them Barabbas. And having Jesus scourged, he delivered him to be crucified. This is when you feel you're getting persecuted. Read this, 16. And this is the most intense. Matthew isn't as intense about it. Luke isn't either, and John isn't. But Mark is. And the soldiers led him inside the palace, that is the praetorium, and they called together the whole cohort, or the whole battalion. Probably about 3,000, 4,000 soldiers. They beat the crap out of him. They literally. St. Catherine Emmerich was a visionary, a nun, and they urinated on him. They defecated on him the night before. There's a well you go to in the Holy Land, and you get to see that. It's in the church of Peter Galigantu, and you go down into that well that he hung, and there's a hole. They peed on him. They defecated on him the night before for our salvation, because we are sinners. But that's not what we are when God looks at us. When God looks at us, he sees that we're his sons. I always tell people, what does God see in you? Oh, I'm a sinner. No. God sees that you are his son first, and your daughter, you are his daughter or his son. Mark 15:16-17, and they clothed him in a purple cloak, and plaiting a crown of thorns, they put it on him, and they began to salute him, "Hail, King of the Jews," and they struck his head with a reed, and they spat upon him. He did that for us, brothers. Do you believe it with your whole heart and soul? Do I? Just because I'm a priest doesn't mean I believe it. I've got to daily intend it. I got to say, Jesus, I want you into my heart. I accept you. I need you. You're the vine. I'm the branch. I'm going to try to be the vine today. I'm not the vine. You are. But you got to know his words to pray to him. And why not use his words? Amen? Why not use his words? Study scripture, and then what's going to happen is you're going to convert a lot of people to Catholicism. I'm in a town of I'm in a parish of 90 families. We've had 30 converts in 6 years. 30. Because of this book. Because people read it, we do Bible studies, and then they go out. I asked this one lady at the grocery store, hey, I was talking with her, and she's like, I said, you should come to St. Anthony. She goes, I know. I've been told that 5 times this week. She teaches at the local public high school. 3 of our kids said, you should be Catholic. Why? Why should they be Catholic? There's a lot of evangelicals that are fired up, amen? There's a lot of Methodists and Lutherans that are great Christians, but they do not have the Eucharist. They do not have it. Go to John 6:51. This is why I'm Catholic, this verse. We had Mass a couple years ago, 4 years ago, John 6:51. Thanks for following along and looking in your Bible. This is great. John 6:51. Say John 6:51. So this evangelical comes to Mass on a Christmas Eve one, and I saw him, and I know he was an evangelical. I know that he's not a big Catholic, and I'm like, holy mama! He's at Mass, because we have a good view, priests, and we can see who's there. We also can see when they fall asleep, right? And I'm like, Dean is here! And I preach with the Bible in my hand. I have the Bible when I preach, and I walk around. And he was just like, but that's not what changed him. What changed him was when I stood at the altar, and I said, this is my body. He read the Gospels. He's instant conversion in the Eucharist. Then 2 days later, we were at a basketball game, packed gym. I sat right next to him. He's like, Father? And we gave the book, Matthew Kelly's Rediscovering Catholicism, out after Mass. He took it and read it, stayed up till 2:30 in the morning, 3 in the morning, finished it. Came to the basketball game. I was sitting next to him. He's like, Father, I'd like to talk to you. I knew exactly why. I was like, I'm going to start selling. I feel like I'm a salesman. I sell insurance. Life, health, and fire. I love when a couple times I go to Wrigley Field. I love Wrigley Field, and I wear casual clothes, and they'll ask me, so what do you do? You know, you start talking to people you sit next to. I go, oh, I sell insurance. And then I lead them along. And then they're like, so who do you sell for? I go, I sell for the Pope. Isn't it fun to be I love being a priest. And then after I do that, they kind of feel like, they think, did I cuss since I've been sitting with it? And then when it happens, I'm like, boo! It is so fun being a Catholic. And I get to be a priest on top of it. I get to say words, and people have sin on their heart, and it leaves. Jesus does it. Like St. Paul says in 1 Cor 15:10, I am what I am by the grace of God. But John 6:51, look what it says here, guys. Is this not awesome? Is this not fire you up? Does this fire you up? You got people in your life that aren't going to Mass. I got them in my life. John 6:51. I am the living bread which came down from heaven. Whoever eats this bread will live forever, and the bread that I shall give is my flesh. It's going to be a little different translation there, but it's the same thing. I am the living bread. When I teach kids, I always do a little bit of a little twang so they remember. Say, I am. The living bread. No, bread. I'm the living bread. Which came down from heaven. Whoever eats this bread will live forever. I mean, I lost my best friend 6 years ago, my dad. I miss him terribly. He would have been here. He would have been sitting here with me. I miss him every day, but that verse consoles me because he ate the body and blood of Jesus. Whoever eats this bread will live forever. I believe my dad is living forever. Live forever. And the bread that I shall give is my flesh for the life of the world. Look what it says there. Then we go to Mass and we can't even use the missalette. We can't even genuflect right. People picking their fingernails. My Bible study of guys, that's what they do. They clean my church. And they clean in our high school, the girls. I have a girls group. I have a boys group, the Bobs, the Brothers of the Beatitudes. In a girls group, the Daughters of the Beatitudes. And they clean the chapel. And you know what they find? Fingernail clippings. Because people bite their fingernails at Mass. It drives me nuts. Are you excited about being a Catholic?
Yes.
You need to be a better Catholic.
Yes.
Because I certainly do. I need to be a better disciple of Jesus. But he never gives up on me. Remember a couple weeks ago in Luke 13 about the fig tree? And he comes 3 years. And then the father says, cut it down. It's wasting soil. He goes, no. I will, one more year. I'm going to fertilize it and cultivate. I'll do it. Love that. Say John 6:51. This is what, literally Jesus lives in us. He lives in us. Go to Galatians 2. You guys know the 27 books of the New Testament in order? Okay, you should know them in order. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts, Romans. Right? 206, thank you. 206. Galatians 2:20. This is Paul. Love Paul. If you've never read him, 13 letters. Take you 81 days to do that. Take you 89 days to read the Gospels and 81 to read Paul. It'll take you 6 months to read half of the New Testament. And no one does it! Except this little town where I live. One of my boys, he's a big golfer. So his best friend's dad's a Lutheran minister. And they're golfing. And Trevor's memorized 20 verses. And the pastor's like, you know what I don't like about Catholics? They don't know the Gospels. And Trevor's competitive. He's competitive, and so he has memorized probably 20 gospel verses. And so he's playing golf. And he goes, oh, Mark 13:13. You'll be hated by all because of my name, but those who persevere to the end will be saved. The Lutheran pastor's like, you're Catholic. He goes, yeah, it's the word of God, and I know it, and I memorize it at my local Catholic church. Okay? Start doing it, brothers. It'll change your life. When you have an addiction, a problem, not a counselor. This. Now, a counselor, yes. Okay? If you need to go to a counselor, fine. But this book will change your life. Amen?
Amen.
This book, alone, by yourself, no one around you. The best place to do it is in adoration. And you sit and you listen. I am the bread of life. Whoever believes in me, I'm the living bread. You got to put it in the head. You will have trouble in this world, but take courage. I've conquered the world. John 16:33. Okay? Galatians 2:20. I've been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. Do you believe that? Say, I believe it. Say, Christ lives in me. Say, if I have an addiction, I can be overcome by it. If I try to solve it myself. But with Jesus, I can overcome anything. Galatians 2, I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. I now live by the faith in the Son of God who has loved me and has given himself up for me. Can you hear that? I feel like I can hear little crickets. Somebody's like, cricket, cricket. You guys love being Catholic?
Yes.
I hope you have someone you're missioning to try to become Catholic. Because someday when we die, Jesus is going to say, here's all the people that I've put in your life to become Catholic. It is the greatest belief and faith in the world. Amen?
Amen.
Okay? And we have it all. We have it all. It subsists in the Catholic Church according to Vatican Council II. It subsists in the Catholic Church is the line they use. And if you go out in Cedar Rapids and all over Iowa and do this, get ready. Get ready. I live in a town of 75 people live in my town. I have a parish of 90 families. 4 years ago, we had to redo our church. We raised $620,000 in 1 year, paid the whole thing off, 90 families. We raised $340,000 in 10 days, cash. People said, how'd you do it? We did it by Jesus. Jesus is good at raising money. You laugh, but it's true. Say, I am the vine. You are the branches. Whoever remains in me, and I in him, will bear much fruit. For without me, you can do nothing. Say, I am the branch. He's the vine. Don't forget it, brothers. Do not forget that. That's John 15:5. Go to John 15:9. Thanks for doing this, brothers. And you're going to have a breakout session this afternoon. I just see him here, Mr. Justin Fatika, who's one of the best speakers in the country. You want to see someone who's, I know he reads the Bible, correct? Yeah. I mean, you want to see an intense guy. Good night, Irene. He came to Nebraska. He got this big old football player to start bawling because of Jesus. Intense. When I heard he was coming, I was like, sweet, I want to listen to him. John 15:9. It's great to see you, Mr. Fatika. John 15:9. Say, as the Father loves me, so I love you. Remain in my love. I mean, come on, guys. Is that good enough? There's like 8,000 verses in the New Testament. As the Father loves me, so I love you. Remain in my love. I taught kindergartners this. Then we did it like 5 times. Then I went to the football game on Friday night, and this mom was like, please don't teach my kids any more things. He goes around the house. As the Father loves me, so I love you. Remain in my love. Say, as the Father loves me, so I love you. Remain in my love. Can you do the little shimmy? Maybe not? Okay. But have it on your head when you get grouchy, when you get frustrated, when something doesn't go right, right? Does that ever happen in our life? Say, as the Father loves me, so I love you. Remain in my love. Say, remain in my love. So when you're at the Walmart and she makes three mistakes and she's you know, things are going, you gotta wait in line, right? And then you're nice to her, she'll say, well, thank you. And then you say, well, as the Father loves me, so I love you, remain in my love. John 15:9, that's why I'm patient with you, because Jesus loves me like the Father loves him. And say John 15:9, and say, do you know Jesus Christ loves you? I do this through drive-thrus, it's the greatest. And through when you go out to eat, with three priests, we go out to eat, we go somewhere different all the time. And we went, and this lady had she had tattooed an anchor, which is a symbol of hope. And I said, oh, you're a Christian. She goes, no, I'm not a Christian. I said, did you know? So we start evangelizing. But we don't do it by talking. I said to her, okay, your tip is going to depend if you can answer this question. You're getting 20%. You start with 20% because you don't earn salvation. It's bought and paid for. Luke 5. You will have no inheritance with me. So she said, you get 20% if you can answer this question. She goes, I haven't been to church in a long time. I'm like, why do you think it's going to be a church question? Because you're a priest? I go, it's how many Ten Commandments are there? She's like, 10. I'm like, sweet, you get 20%. She goes, that's it? I'm like, Jesus is very easy. Go to him. Religion is not hard. Go to Jesus. You guys know the Ten Commandments, right? Can you give them to me right now in order? They're in Exodus 20, Deuteronomy 5. Can you give them like that to me? Here we go. Say one God, holy name, holy day. Say one God, holy name, holy day. Say one God, holy name, holy day. Mom and dad, dad and mom, don't kill, don't cheat, don't steal, don't lie, don't covet neighbor's wife, don't covet neighbor's goods. There they all are. Say one God, holy name, holy day. One God, holy name, holy day. Say one God, holy name, holy day. Mom and dad, dad and mom. You're like, what? Say one God. No one knows the commandments. People are like, well, am I supposed to know them in order? I don't know. He gave them an order. Amen? Say one God. Holy name. Holy day. Can you imagine how many times his name is said in vain? One God, holy name. Say one God, holy name. You know why his name's in vain? Because people who stand next to people who say his name in vain are cowards and they don't say anything. They don't try to help people change their life because they're cowards, because they don't want to suffer. You will have trouble in this world. You will be hated by all. Mark 13:13, John 16:33. Say one God, holy name. One God, holy name. Say one God, holy name, holy day. One God, holy name, holy day. Mom and dad, dad and mom. I'll just say one God. Use your hand. Say one God, holy name, holy day. Mom and dad, dad and mom. The reason is because when you go to Exodus 20 and Deuteronomy 5, there's a blessing attached to that commandment. It's the only one. When you honor your father and your mother, you get a reward. According to Exodus 20 and Deuteronomy 5. Say, don't kill. Don't cheat. Don't steal. Don't lie. Don't covet neighbor's wife. No, don't covet neighbor's wife. You come to my parish in Steiner, all my kids know them like that. All of them. Because I got tired of it. Say one God. Thank you very much. Holy name. Holy day. Mom and dad, dad and mom. Don't kill. Don't cheat. We don't say don't commit adultery because kids don't understand that. You go to, you know, they come into confession. I hit my dog, punched my sister, committed adultery. Whoa, hello. Say one God. Holy name. Best day of the year is first penance. I love that. Me and there's like six priests, we're on a group text. I'm like, God, first penance today. It's the best day of the year because these kids are like, bless me, Father, for I have sinned. And they're so innocent. They're Matthew 18:1-5. Unless you turn and become like a little child, you don't inherit the kingdom of God. Best thing is first penance day. These kids are so innocent. And they're all so humble. And they go through the commandments. They're like, one God, I didn't do this. Holy name, holy day. Mom and dad, dad and mom say, don't kill, don't cheat, don't steal, don't lie, Don't covet neighbor's wife. Don't covet neighbor's goods. Now, when you're good, when you get fast, one God, holy name, mama, dad, mom, don't kill, don't cheat, don't steal, don't lie, don't covet neighbor's wife, don't covet neighbor's good. Say one God, holy name, holy day, mama, dad, mom. If you do this and you go somewhere, go out and public, go out to complete strangers. I do this all the time. It's the best. I do it through drive-thrus. And I go, I'd like to give a picture of my best friend, Jesus Christ, to you. And this guy's like, sweet, I love Jesus. Through the McDonald's drive-thru, it's the best. I'm going to confession, I go to McDonald's. But, right? Say one God.
God.
Holy name.
Holy day.
Holy day. Mom and dad and mom. Don't kill. Don't cheat. Don't steal. Don't lie. Don't covet neighbor's wife. Don't covet neighbor's goods. We got a few minutes before I end my first talk. Okay? Now, the most important part of the New Testament to follow Jesus are these 8 points, and no one knows these. If I asked you, name me the 8 Beatitudes right now, all in order, name them for me. Most people can't. How are we supposed to follow him if we don't know what he says? Correct? So go there. You know where it is? It's in Matthew chapter what, do you think? 5, excellent. Say Matthew 5, 3 to 12. Say Matthew 5, 3 to 12. Matthew 5, 3 to 12. You'll remember if you put a little jingle to it. Matthew 5, 3 to 12. I go to visit the missionaries of charity, and I teach them sometimes. You want to see the missionary of charity do it. They're like, Matthew 5, 3 to 12. These sisters, there's like 30 of them. I gave them a conference. They're awesome. But I do it by the sprinkler. Right? Matthew 5, 3 to 12. You should see the sisters do that. They'll do that. I'll teach them it, then I'll go back later in the afternoon, like at 3, like 2:50, I got there early, and they were in their little room, and they were like, Matthew 5, 3 to 12. They're like, shh, he's coming, he's coming. Say, blessed are the poor in spirit. So that means to be humble. We're going to talk about these in my second talk this afternoon. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Say, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Say, blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. That's when there's a heavy cross, like when your spouse dies. My godmother, she lives in a care facility here, and she's got Alzheimer's. And it's just hurting her husband, who's my godfather and uncle. And literally, Jesus is closest to him now than he ever has been. You know, when you lose a spouse, people in my parish, they've lost spouses, they're terribly sad. Terribly sad. That's this beatitude. Say, blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the land. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for holiness, for they shall be satisfied. See, when you're growing in holiness, it doesn't matter if someone hates us. Well, you'll be hated by all because of my name, Mark 13, 13. Okay, thank you. You can hate me. I'm going to have trouble in this world, John 16, 33. It's the fourth beatitude. Fifth one, say, blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Remember Aliaka? He shot John Paul II, and then John Paul II went to him and said, I forgive you. That's because of that beatitude. It's because John Paul II was a disciple of Jesus. He forgave him. And you know what Aliaka said to him, right? He didn't say, oh, thank you, I'm sorry I did that. He goes, I should have killed you. I'm a good marksman. He didn't ever apologize to him. That's because of the fifth beatitude, brothers. If you want to fall in love with someone, fall in love with John Paul II. Fall in love with him. Read everything you can on him. First book, Jason Everett's. It's an easy read. 5 Loves of John Paul II. Hopefully they have it out there. Say, blessed are the pure of heart, for they shall see God. Not a lot of people are seeing God right now, because we got a major problem with that one. And we're not talking just of pornography and impurity. Okay? We're talking about people who are angry. If you saw Chicago yesterday. Okay? People who are hatred. People who are angry. That's pure of heart. That's why you got to have this book. That's why you got to get up an hour early or 20 minutes early and, okay, I'm reading today. And you do this, it will change your life. And I guarantee you, one person here, and it might be me, or at the gates of hell, that if we died, we might go to hell today. John Paul II wrote a book called Crossing the Threshold of Hope when I was a junior in high school, and he wrote it in that book. He said, not a lot of people talk about hell today. If all go to heaven, why be good on earth? Why be a saint? Blessed are the pure of heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called children of God. Blessed are you when they insult you and persecute you and utter every evil against you falsely because of me. Rejoice and be glad for your reward. You ready for the reward? We're going to talk this afternoon about the crown. You ever know how many times in the Bible the word crown is? I've been studying it for a while and I found a few. The word crown, we're going to talk about that. The face of the Father's mercy, brothers, is this. If you don't have this image in your house, put it in your house. Put this image in your house if you don't. This converts people. I have one of these in my, where we do marriage prep, when I have to talk on birth control. Before we talk on birth control and the church's teaching, which most people don't accept and don't follow, we pray the Divine Mercy Chaplet, and I give them this image to look at and to meditate on. It converts people's hearts. This afternoon, we're going to, you got to hear me one more time for an hour. Less purgatory time. Suffering builds endurance, endurance builds character, character builds hope. That's Romans 5, 3-5. So you're suffering. I appreciate your time. Know the Beatitudes and know the Ten Commandments. Amen?
Amen.
We started with John 10:10, the abundant life. Then we went into Luke 6:27, love your enemies, right? Then we went to John 15:5. I'm the vine, you're the branches, whoever remains in me. Then we went to Mark 15. Then we went to Matthew 14. When you memorize this stuff, someone says, you don't write your talks down. Why would I need to walk my talks down? Why do I need to write them down? I don't write them down because I spend time with this. I slack on most things, like working out. Okay? As my spiritual director's on my tail about it. He's like, Courtney! I'm like, I know! But one thing I do, I skip a lot of things, but one thing I do is I read this book every morning. I say my office, which is what I promised, but I read this book, and I hope to God and beg you to read it. I've been on my knees. I skip most things, but one thing I don't skip, on my knees, and I prayed for you for a year in my little chapel called the Divine Mercy Chapel in my little town. Please pray for me. Okay? I need your prayers. And I need your prayers for a kid right now who's addicted to marijuana, who sometimes calls me at 2 o'clock in the morning. He did it last week. He said, are you up? Father, are you up? Well, I'm up now. Who loves being Catholic? Who loves Jesus? Say, I love being Catholic.
I love being Catholic.
Keep your hands up. Say, I love being Catholic.
I love being Catholic.
And then go like this. Go, woo. Peace.